So, John chapter 15, there at verse 12, down to verse 17. This is my commandment, that ye love one another as I have loved you. Greater love hath no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friends. Ye are my friends, if ye do whatsoever I command you. Henceforth I call you not servants, for the servant knoweth not what his Lord doeth, but I have called you friends, for all things that I have heard of my Father I have made known unto you. Ye have not chosen me, but I have chosen you and ordained you, that ye should go and bring forth fruit, and that your fruit should remain, that whatsoever ye shall ask of the Father in my name, he may give it you. These things I command you, that ye love one another. And so we're abiding in his provision, you know, and I'm trying to move this down here a little bit to this letter B is where we were working on the fact that the Lord has chosen you and I for a purpose. You see that in verse 16, ye have not chosen me, but I have chosen you and ordained you. And so, you know, God, through Jesus Christ, has chosen us to bring forth fruit. Amen. That's what he's chosen us to do. You know, we're going to be taking a look at the theological battle that comes around often about, you know, being chosen, predestinated, and all those kind of ideas that were the elect before the foundation of the world, all those come up. But you notice here it says, chosen, ordained you, that ye should go and bring forth fruit. I mean, that's what he's chosen us for. There's no context of, I've chosen you for heaven, or I've chosen you for hell, which is what the false doctrine of predestination is all about. Of course, what we looked at last time before we closed the day was that, you know, none of us really jumped up and down and says, choose me, I really want to be the one to be the servant to burn out for you, choose me, you know, but God chosen us.
If he's not willing that any should perish, how would he predestinate people to hell?
That's what we're going to get to. Yeah, exactly right. That's exactly right. They have to throw those verses out. So we understand here that he's already said to all of us that are saved that he's chosen us to bring forth fruit. That's what we know is going on here. So this is that this false teaching that some have taught, that this means that Jesus was destining, you know, some people to heaven and some people to hell. That's what they think. You know, anytime that you have where, you know, they've got there's certain key words, you know, that people get all shook up about. You know, and there's some people, you know, that want to believe that you get to heaven because you're baptized. So every time they see the word water, oh, wow, that's got to be baptized, you know, no matter what, you know. And they just get all excited about that because they think their baptism is going to get them to heaven. And then there's some people that teach this false idea about predestination, that God, through Jesus Christ, determined that certain people are going to heaven, certain people are going to hell. And, you know, if you go to hand somebody a gospel tract like we did yesterday, and they say no, well, they're destined to hell. You know, that's just how God's chosen, that they're not going to heaven.
A couple people said no to Johann.
Yeah, wow, that's incredible to think about. That's unusual.
Well, yeah, it's like some people are like, yeah, we already got one because we're kind of behind, so we're probably getting everyone in the mess, but, yeah. A couple people literally said, "No, I don't want one of those."
Wow, that's incredible to the child.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, well, they must be predestined to hell then. That's that idea. And of course, if they took it, well, they must be predestined to heaven. By the way, what's that?
What do they do with people that sometimes it's six or seven times before they get saved?
Right. Yeah. Even when I was lost, I would have taken one of those.
Sure.
Even if I didn't agree, it's like, hey, someone's giving me something.
Yeah.
They could see the idea of having such a hard heart.
Yeah, yeah.
But God can work through that.
Sure.
Amen.
Yeah. Of course, some of that idea with this is that, you know, that's also part of this whole false idea, is that we don't have to tell people about Jesus Christ. If they're predestined to heaven, they're going to walk through the door and get saved. Sometime in their lifetime, they'll get saved on their own. We don't have to tell them anything about it. So we don't need to be missionary-minded. We don't need to be... And, you know, there are some churches out there that are called missionary Baptist churches. You know, Pastor Lamus is in the Independent Missionary Baptist Church of El Cajon. You know, and that's the reaction. They didn't want to be thought of at all of this idea of, you know, the predestination and all. And so they put right in the title of their church, missionary. That means they're going to tell people about Jesus Christ. Yeah, right?
Was it the Puritans, some of the people they kill by, you know, cutting off their ears and dragging them by horseback?
Was that Puritans or what?
Puritans.
Puritans, right, yes,
yeah,
Puritans, yes.
Like pilgrims and whoever they did that to.
Pilgrims weren't, yeah.
Yeah, but whoever Puritans would kill for that, they'd say, well, if they tried preaching to the natives,
right,
because they were so lost that they couldn't come to Jesus, so trying to give them the gospel was heresy.
Yeah, that's what they thought, see.
Yeah.
That's the kinds of things they thought.
Yeah, God.
How can you hear except there be a
question? Well, that's what we've got up here. This idea is not consistent with other scripture, right?
Faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by
hearing by the word of God.
Well,
and
they
all.
Have this,
yep.
They have this thing at some college in California or whatever, where they tried to deem this exhibit racist of this missionary telling these natives about Jesus Christ.
Yes.
Yeah. It's like, okay, well,
yeah, we weren't.
Right now, my great grandfather was a missionary to the native people in the Northeast, and my great grandmother came to Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah.
It works.
It works. Yeah, it sure does. So we know here in 2 Peter chapter 3 and verse 9. It says, the Lord is not slack concerning his promise, as some men count slackness, but is long-suffering to usward, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance.
Amen.
You know, and he's long-suffering. I mean, he puts up with people all the way to their death.
Amen.
He tries to get them saved until the day of their death, that moment of their death. He really does,
yeah.
You know. And some people, that's when they do get saved, on their deathbed.
Mm.
So at that funeral that I had Friday, I mean, I said to the folks, we don't know. You know, this fellow might have trusted Christ as his Savior. Yeah, we just don't know when. You know, we just don't. So, you know, like you said earlier, Raph, God's not willing that any should perish. So why would he predestine some? You know, that's inconsistent. Why would he, you know, say, this person, I don't like them enough, they're going on to hell. They're going to burn forever, no matter what they do, no matter, you know, how many times they pray and ask Jesus to be their Savior, they're just going to burn in hell.
It's got to be that some people are just so desperate to be called Christian, but they never read the Bible.
Yeah, I suppose that's got something to do with
it. Yeah, that they'll just... put in their standards, and if you disagree with us, you're not Christian. I don't know, it's in there somewhere. You should read the Bible and you'd know.
Yeah.
They read it, but they make it as a smorgasbord because they're not reading
their own. They do that a lot of times.
Well, they read whatever the pastor tells them to.
Yeah.
And Ezekiel 33:11 says, as I live, saith the Lord God, I have no pleasure in the death of the wicked.
Amen.
But
right.
The wicked turn from his way and live. Turn ye. From evil ways, for why will you die?
Yeah.
O house of Israel.
Yeah.
That applies to everybody.
Sure.
No pleasure.
No pleasure in the death of the wicked.
Why would Christ want to go to the cross just for a few when he could the whole
go
world?
Go for all of them. Yep.
And all the verses with whosoever.
Yes, and that's
how
what
people come.
How self-righteous can you be? If you actually believe in Jesus Christ, how self-righteous would you have to be to think it's not for everybody.
Yeah. Well, you got to remember this. What we did yesterday was a lot of hard work. No doubt about it. I mean, that was hard work yesterday. Toil, if you will. That was hard work to do what we did yesterday. And there's a lot of people who just don't want to do that. They don't want to be bothered. They don't want to leave their comfort zone. They don't want to get sunburned passing out tracks. They don't want to do that. You know? Next week, my ears will probably be all peeled. You know, I'll come into church. I'll have all these white things hanging off from my ears. You know, I look like snake molting. You know, shedding his skin next week. They just don't want to. They just want to bother. You know, so tell people about Jesus Christ. Don't want to do that. Revelation chapter 22, verse 17. And the Spirit and the Bride say, "Come." And let him that heareth say, "Come." And let him that is athirst come. And whosoever will, let him take the water of life freely. You know, whosoever will. And it's just incredible.
Interesting. It says come three times.
It's interesting. It does. Yes. Three times says come. So God has a purpose for your life.
Amen.
Isn't that something? That's a wonderful thing. You know, you're not just to wake up and then eat breakfast and go to work and come home and, you know, watch some TV, go to bed. Next day, you do the same thing all over again. Do the same thing all over again, you know. He's got a purpose, and it's some good things. But you have to abide in him for him to reveal that to you. You know, it just doesn't, you know, come, you know. Well, he's going to send you a letter in the mail. This is your purpose. You know, or you're going to get a text on your phone. I wish it were that easy, but it doesn't work that way. And the Bible says here in John 15, verse 16, "You have not chosen me, but I have chosen you and ordained you." And ordained you. He has chosen you. He has ordained you. Isn't that incredible? Wow. Wait a minute here. You know, we got ordained. I thought the pastor was ordained. And one of these days we'll have Brother John get ordained. Amen. I think he's brought ready for it soon here. But ordained means placed in ministry. Tony, you've been placed in ministry.
Amen.
That's what you has happened to you. You're in a ministry there in getting the word of God out around the world. That's your ministry. It's just incredible. Raph, you've been placed in ministry. Miss Mary, you've been placed in ministry. Brother John, you've been placed. What's that?
Mary's doing it right now.
Mary's doing it right now, right at the moment.
We
yeah.
All are.
Yesterday it was a different ministry.
Yeah.
You know, we've been placed in ministry. It's not just for pastors. That's what a lot of times people think. You know? We don't know necessarily feel like we've been called to the ministry, but every one of us has been placed in ministry. Jesus said that he's called us and chosen us and placed us in ministry, ordained us. It's not just for the pastor.
Amen.
And honestly, every area's got their own culture, their own idiosyncrasies, if you will. But the Detroit area was so unionized, really. I mean, it was so unionized that they thought, well, pastor, that's your job. We don't do that. That's not part of our job to tell others about Christ, pass out tracts. You know, that's what we hire you for. That's your union job. And my union job is to sit here and pay you to do it. You know, that was their mentality, honest. It was really something. You know, or we can't do that. That's not part of our trade. You know, that's your trade. That's wow, that was hard to overcome. It really was. Raph, your mind's going.
Well,
what's the question?
Well, I'd be wondering, one, would Detroit be like that now, seeing as.
Yeah, maybe not now, but.
African-style unemployment.
Yeah, maybe not now, but 20 years ago, sure was. Yeah, it sure was.
So there's a way to. there's a way to break a mindset if you don't work through it.
Huh? Yeah, yeah.
Well, yeah. The ministry is, you know, servant, you know, service.
Service, yeah.
You know, that's, everybody has those opportunities in any given day to serve.
To serve. Others. And they've been given Holy Spirit gifts mm-hmm. to serve.
Yeah.
I mean, that's the reason why they're there. Mm-hmm. You know? So just like the tissue that forms your eyeball has been given the gift to see, that's its purpose and all, so then it helps the whole body to see. Mm-hmm. That's why that was so funny yesterday. We're lining up and whoever was in the minion costume couldn't see. You know, they couldn't see. So they're trying to walk, so they can't tell. They're doing
the
like
shoes.
Like this. And then Tony, they had somebody put them on their arm. Okay, now they're walking a little bit better. They're walking along. That was so cute. And then they come to this like little pothole thing in the, and whoever was walking with them didn't tell them there's a pothole there, and they about fell over. It was so funny to watch. So I didn't see him walking in the parade. Did you see the minion walking in the parade, blue overalls and all bright yellow with the one eye in the front? Not the one eye with the fuzz all around it, like from Monsters, Inc., I think that one's from, isn't it?
Right.
That
yeah.
one? Yeah, but the minion, you know, like a... You didn't see that one, Tony?
Plumber guy.
Yeah, plumber or whatever they are, you know, with the one eye thing. Your dad asked him, do you ever blink? With the one eye. Yeah.
Wink.
What's that?
Wink,
yeah. So... You know, we're every one of us called to be a servant. You know, we need that. So, you know, and some tissue on your body is called to be a little toe. You need your little toe, especially if you're turning, or if you're running barefoot in the sand trying to catch Johann. You need that little toe. Yeah. Yeah. Amen.
Well, nothing works well if one little thing, you know.
Is out.
Working, yeah.
Is out.
It hurts,
yeah.
Affects the rest of the body.
Yeah, it sure does. Yeah. So I've got a question up here. Yeah. You know, why does Jesus desire that we serve him in ministry? Why does he? Got a question up here.
Well, you know, I've been able to experience things like Jesus Christ. I've been better able to identify with, you know, my Savior through the service.
Through the service, yeah.
And didn't have that relationship, understanding, mm-hmm. so I can better know Him.
Yes.
And His sufferings and His...
That's what Peter talks about, yeah.
His suffering. Through service, we give Him glory.
Yes.
He gives us rewards.
And He gives us rewards. Yeah. Quite incredible, right? So the answer is found there in verse 16 of John, that ye should go and bring forth fruit, and that your fruit should remain. You know, to think about the fact that, you know, you gave a gospel tract to somebody, they came to know Jesus Christ as Savior, who knows what they'll go on to do, you know, for the Savior, and then they'll because they've trusted Christ as their Savior, they're forever in heaven. You know, that's just incredible. Talk about fruit that remains. Mm-hmm. You know, that's just incredible. So we, you know, we're just amazing to think about that.
Amen.
Yeah, just amazing. You know, I mean, I could build a house, and I have built a house. I could build a house. You know, it's not going to remain. You know, I mean, it still looks pretty good right now, but who knows 100 years from now what it'll look like. Fall down, whatever.
Yeah. Well, and there are places that are for thousands of years old.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah.
But not centuries and centuries.
Yeah.
Instead of stone.
Right, unless they're made out of stone.
Cave.
But, you know, what we do for Christ will last forever. See, God's plan when He ordained us was so that we'd have spiritual fruit, that we'd bear spiritual fruit. I mean, that's the most important thing, that we bear spiritual fruit.
Well, it's neat when somebody, you know, asks a question and they're hurting or they don't know certain mm-hmm. things, and you can share from God's word.
You sure.
know, you know, somebody that had an abortion, they were wondering if their child was going to be in heaven. And
sure.
I could go to, you know, 2 Samuel and David and, mm-hmm. you know, from his first relationship with Bathsheba and show that, you know, he'd go to the child one day.
Right.
You know, that's why he could get up and go about his business.
Right. Knew where the child was.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. They can comfort the person.
And yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
They
can
help us think with that. It's like, maybe it's just my own thought here, that David wouldn't go to battle against the king.
Uh huh.
And he went to battle against Goliath, but we talk a lot about the Lord's anointed.
Uh huh.
And maybe rather than just, you know, tells men to avoid the king. It was just like getting to the point, I'm not going to fight if I'm going against the king.
Hmm.
And then, yeah. you know, the devil uses reverence for that office against him.
Sure, yeah.
Well, because think about it. Jesus Christ is King of Kings, Lord of Lords, so mm-hmm. God's like, mm-hmm. I like somebody who is going to reverence that position.
Reverence that idea, yeah. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Okay, we come to the conclusion. Now, this is kind of surprising here. There are three primary reasons why people commit suicide. This is quite interesting. This is worth studying, worth understanding here. First of all, they feel that no one loves them. Nobody loves me. Everybody hates me. Oh, how I like worms. You know, fat ones, juicy ones, squirmy ones, slimy ones. I just eat some worms. I don't remember how the song goes, something like that. You know, nobody loves me. Well, that's what some people think. That's why it's important that we as Christians let each other know that we love each other.
Amen.
You know, a lot of times we don't know how hurting somebody is when they come in the door. And just to have somebody tell them, I love you and praying for you, important. Very, very important. The second thing is they feel they have no true friends. They got friends, but no true friends. Yeah, there's a difference there. You know, you can know people, but they're not necessarily their friends. Acquaintance. Yeah. And then the third reason is that they feel like they have no purpose in life. Mm-hmm. There's no real purpose for them. Oh, I got to get that on this sheet. Sorry about that, my young pupils. No purpose. What's the use? Why try? Why do it? You know, And that's a shame they feel that way, but they really do feel that way. You know, they really do feel that way. Here's the amazing thing. You know, in Jesus Christ, all three points are covered.
Amen.
Huh. In Jesus Christ, all three points are covered. He loves you with an undying love. He's a friend that sticketh closer than the brother. And he's chosen you and ordained you that you'd bring forth fruit for him. Mm-hmm. Given you a purpose in life. Made you a servant. Yeah? Isn't that Amen. Something? What our heart cries out most for is what Jesus Christ fulfills
yep.
in our life. It's just amazing. Just amazing. I mean, I know for myself, I was searching. I didn't think anybody loved me. I did not think anyone loved me. Here I am, a hippie. Living in communes, peace, love, dove, all that stuff, you know. We got free love, and we're going on and on.
And that's why the devil hammers those three points.
Oh, yeah.
Because Jesus fulfills all of them, so he wants to pile on
yep.
all those other ones.
Yep, he makes you think nobody loves you. Makes yep. you think you had a friend in the world. Makes you think you have no purpose in life. You know, what am I doing? I just get up every day, do the same thing every day. And, Yeah.
How aggressive old hippies are.
What about aggressive?
How aggressive old hippies are.
Oh, are they?
Yeah, there's one guy was telling me yesterday about the guy was threatening me Christmas Eve a couple of years ago.
Oh.
And I guess, you know, I wouldn't want to worry. It's like, wait, he said, is he serious about all those death threats on you? It's like, yeah.
Huh?
Said, don't worry too much. He's just a cantankerous old man. It's like, nice word. Cantankerous,
yep. Before we realize it, Jesus meets all those needs.
Amen.
Amen. You know, before we even realize what those are, he's taking care of them for us. You know. Don't we sing about how much Jesus loves us? Yeah, it's just amazing.
And we're yet enemies.
Yeah. God commendeth his love toward us in that while we're yet sinners, Christ died for us, Romans 5:8.
Yeah, for if when we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his Son. Much more being reconciled, we shall be saved by his life.
Yeah. See how that all fits? Amen. Yeah. That's why he invites us here into this kind of a relationship, that we'd abide in him and he in us. And that's so important. That's where we find true love and close relationship and friendship and eternal purpose is in abiding in him.
Amen.
It's just a wonderful thing. And I know, I honestly know, this Sunday school set of lessons has just been hammering this abide in Christ. Okay, you know, yeah. It's for that reason, amen? So we've got wonderful provision, abiding in his provision. He provides the love and the relationship and the purpose. That's how he provides for us. Amen?
Mm-hmm.
Harriet Beecher Stowe had a booklet called How to Live in Christ. And in it she makes this statement. How does the branch bear fruit? Not by incessant effort for sunshine and air, not by vain struggles. It simply abides in the vine in silent and undisturbed union, and blossoms and fruit appear as of spontaneous growth. You know, it just, okay, Lord, here I am, do through me whatever you want. Whatever you want. As you abide in Christ, a wonderful transformation comes about. It just does. You'll become like him. It's amazing. Yeah, just amazing. You'll become like him. Yeah. Here's God's ultimate will. All right? This is his ultimate will. Somebody said it this way. He loved Jesus Christ so much, he wants a lot more to look like him, be like him. That's what he does. He conforms us to the image of his Son. Raph, do you remember how many times I've told you, what does it mean to conform something? Remember how I pictured that?
To set it how he wanted to do.
Well, close. Close. But it's like taking a mold and pressing it into the mold so every time it comes out, it looks just like what the mold said it was supposed to look like. And Jesus Christ is the mold. And God presses us into him. And when we come out, guess what? Look just like Jesus Christ. You know, he conforms us.
He's the potter and we're the clay, so he always...
Yeah, he forms us, shapes us. Yeah,
conforming.
That's how the songwriter wrote it. Stamp thine own image into my heart. Look
there's,
it up.
There's a way people run with that too.
Yeah.
And the contrary, they say everyone will look just like Jesus in heaven.
Yeah.
And it's like, I don't know. It's like we might have a spirit, but God made people,
right,
everyone unique. So it's like,
I've even heard a guy say, because he wants to be thought of, that every word in the Bible, he takes it literally just like it says. So because we shall be like him, you know, the scripture says we shall be like him. He says that even the women are going to be 30-year-old men.
Yeah, I've heard that. It's like, wait a second, how do we recognize Jesus then?
Yeah. There you go. Yeah. So, dear ones, this is going to lead us to part two of our study. We've been looking at, you know, not right now, but come next Sunday, Lord willing. You know, we've been looking at, and I said we've been hammered about this. You got to abide in the vine. You must abide in the vine. It's profitable for you to abide in the vine. Bam, da bam, da bam. If you got this thing, abide, abide. You know, it just keeps smacking you in the face. Okay, the next section is, well, okay, if we're supposed to do that, answer this question for me, Pastor. How do we do it? So we're going to have next few weeks at how, or well, more than a few weeks, probably next couple months, at how do we do it. We're going to discover how this wonderful abiding relationship will change us to be more like Jesus Christ. How's that come about? How do we do it? You know, God's saying to us, we got to abide in the vine. How do we do it? Interesting concept. Okay. You got your memory verse there, Isaiah 53:5. But he was wounded for our transgressions, he was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed. Healed of that, no one loves me. Healed of that, you know, I have no friends in this world. Healed of that, I have no purpose in this life.
Amen.
Healed of those things.
That's right.
Oh, my dear ones, quiz time. Here you go. What is God's divine provision? God's divine provision. Started with peas in our lessons here. Let me help you out. You're all sleeping. God's provision is love here, you know. I'm sorry, this, I said, starts with the peas. I'm thinking in the next question, I'm already too far ahead here. But God's provision is love. He provides love to each one of us.
Amen.
You know, aren't you glad you're loved?
Amen.
Amen. It's not conditional love. I'll love you only if you do these things for me. I'll love you, you know, only if this happens. I'll love you only if, you know.
That's what religion teaches.
Yep. So here's the three provisions of his love. These start with P. Three provisions you're sleeping today. Pardon, partnership, and perspective. You're able to see things in a different way. As he said here, you know, the servant doesn't know what's going on, but friends know. You know, the friend knows. And that's so important for us. Amen. Henceforth, I call you not servants, for the servant knoweth not what his Lord doeth, but I have called you friends. For all things that I have heard of my Father, I have made known unto you. You know, the perspective of it. Like yesterday, you know, we could have gotten all mad, made them, forced them, you know, to move us up to the gazebo so we could have plugged in the electric cord up there somewhere. But the perspective was, well, wait a minute, God's in charge. He knows the best place to put us. You know, up there was a lot muddier. Up there would have been competing with the rock and roll music or jazz music or whatever they had up there.
That's right.
You know, where we were, people all lining up for that photo booth, a lot of people in that area, and the face painting around the corner, and the bathrooms right across from us. So they're all, no, man. God knew, you know, so the perspective, you know, much different there. John chapter 15, verse 14 and 15. What does friend mean? You're my friends. If you do whatsoever I command you, henceforth I call not servants. The servant knoweth not what his Lord doeth, but I have called you friends. For all things that I have heard of my Father I have made known unto you. Friends.
That's
You know the will of...
Remember we talked about the fact that David had a bunch of friends, you know, but what's that relationship still there with them? His mighty men.
You know what's going on with your friend.
You know what's going on, yeah. Do you remember that idea that, yes, we're a friend with Jesus Christ, that doesn't mean we don't respect him and obey him. You know, we don't, you know, like yesterday, we watched, I don't know who gave them out, where they got them, how they got them, but a bunch of the teenage fellas had inflated hammers that were almost as big as they were. You know, and they're friends, all right? Here they are, all friends. But then they started whacking each other with them. I mean, that hurt, you know? You could hear them, you know, cry out and double over and all that with these inflated hammers. And they're whacking each other with them. And, you know, I wouldn't ever think of whacking Jesus Christ with an inflated hammer.
No.
I wouldn't think of that. He's still the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, even though we're friends.
Amen.
So friend... You know, is that idea of the friend of the court, the friend of the inner circle. But it's still court. It's still, he's the king.
Yeah. Respect for that.
Respect.
Authority.
Oh, yeah. You know, he's still God, you know, almighty. And, you know, that's that idea that we're getting at there with friend. You know, it's not just, hey, we're buddies now, we're pals. You know, we're on this equal plane. You know, if I want to do what he wants me to do, that's one thing. But we're friends, so I don't have to do what, you know, he wants me to do. You know, it's a little different than human friends. That makes sense? Yeah. Here's question number 4, dear ones. In what specific ways do we know we are more than servants, but we are God's friends?
Where we know his will, his purpose,
yeah,
and what he's trying to accomplish.
Yeah. And he also gives us a new perspective on life.
Right.
You know, we get to see the bigger picture.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, we get to see the bigger picture. You know, I mean, just think about what lost people have to be thinking about what things are going on in the world. You know? But we've got the bigger picture. We know that we're going to get taken out. There's going to be the 7 years of tribulation. Jesus Christ is going to come back and set up his kingdom, rule and reign. You know, we've got the bigger picture. But they have no idea why these things are coming about. If that Congress had passed that trade act thing for and made Obama the dictator that he wants to be, you know, wouldn't have shook us. We just said, okay, see, everything's lining up for the fact that the Antichrist is going to come on the scene. We're going to be out of here before that happens. There's going to be the 7 year tribulation, and, you know, ISIS is going to set off their atomic bombs. And,
oh, yeah. And
you know?
Obama deserves to be the dictator. He's done so well against the JV team.
Yeah.
And yeah. Those who pervert Islam.
Yeah.
They aren't Islamic. Yet, pretty much control Libya now.
Right.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, Gaddafi had to get out there so ISIS could take over.
Yeah. So here we go. Here's number 5 on our board here. The Sunday school author of this lesson plan wanted us to write down someone we love. Mm-hmm. And then what can we do to show them that we love them today?
Mm.
You know, what can we do to show them that we love them today? That's the question. So, what kinds of things could we do?
Note of encouragement.
Some encouragement.
Yeah.
Yep, note of encouragement. Yeah.
Spend time with them.
Spend some time with them.
Phone call,
tell them.
What you know.
Yep.
Love them.
You can get them some roses, but over in Taiwan, you don't want to get them 4 roses. You know, you want to get them 3, 5, but not 4, you know. Don't ever give them 4. Yeah. So
a four-leaf clover isn't a good thing there?
I'm sorry?
A four-leaf clover wouldn't be...
No, 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 not lucky over there. No, 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 no.
Sign of death.
They'd take out the torch and burn it, Raph, over there. So here we go. You got time to write out a short paragraph. You got paper. You got it on the back here if you want. It's blank on the back of page number 5. A short paragraph. The significance of Christ's provision for us and why we should share that provision with others. You know, if you've never ever thought about a good testimony, an easy testimony is, well, what did Jesus Christ provide you with? You know? He provided me with that love that I so desperately was looking for. You know? I mean, when you're young and your mother spits in your face and says, I hate you, I never want to see you again, you know, you really wonder if you're loved. Yeah, you really do. Yeah. You know, when you get beat all the time, you really wonder if you're loved. So, you know, he provided that. He provided that love and that partnership and, you know, purpose in life. There are some times when I was in between being in the, you know, full-time in the pastorate there, there are some times I'd get the newspaper and start down through the want ads. And I'd start to cry because there wasn't any of them that I wanted to do. And I could do them, but there wasn't any of them that my heart really jumped that I really want to do. No. It's kind of humorous. I don't know why, but I, you know, put my name and stuff on LinkedIn. And every so often LinkedIn sends me this thing about, here's all these jobs that you'd be interested in. Mm-hmm. You know, be the head of the social workers for Catholic Charities. No, I wouldn't be interested in that job. You know, I don't want to do social work. I want to tell people about Jesus Christ, see them come to Christ, see them grow in Christ. There's no greater joy than to see my children walk in truth.
Yeah, it's just incredible. Would get sued for that.
I'm sorry?
A social worker would get sued for that.
Probably would, yes.
Some of the most corrupt people.
Yeah, we had a social worker that went through everything with us and when we were adopting our son, and she went through everything with us, and we witnessed to her. I mean, we tried to win her to Christ every time she came to the house. And she just kind of sit there and, well, you know, I'm here to evaluate these things and this thing and all that kind of thing. And we thought, oy. So then she said, you know, from this, she said, from, you know, your heart attitude, your mental attitude, and these kinds of things, I've determined that, you know, you're fit to, you know, have a child placed in your home. Okay, wonderful. So then they work it all out. Here's the child. And then the judge, finally we go through the whole thing. The judge bangs the gavel, you know, this is your adopted son. She said, I couldn't say anything to you because she came for a visit, follow-up visit. Till after that, you know, she came. She said, I couldn't say anything to you all the while we're interviewing. But she said, I'm a born-again Christian, and I can't have that be part of, and you were so good at trying to win me to Christ. You know, that was so good. You know, she was a dear gal. I really liked her. Yeah. So, you know, the significance. And then compare some ways you spend time with your friends with how you spend time with God. Yeah? How do you spend time with your friends? Yeah? Like go do things with them, talk to them every once in a while.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, think about them.
Think about them, pray for them.
Pray for them.
Yeah, you know. Like that roller derby girl's behind me, and it gave me one of those things, invited me to come last night as if I'd have any energy to do it. Last night to go watch them compete, you know. And my niece does roller derby. So what did I think about? You know, wow, this is neat. I got to tell my niece about that.
Yeah.
You know, and I took the paper, and I don't know if I'll mail it to her or what, but You know, I did a little thing on the on Facebook about, you know, that the roller derby girls were behind me. You know, and I wouldn't let them get by me, is what I said. Yeah. But they all looked at me like, you know how easy it would be for us to get by you, you know.
They didn't have any banner in front of them, did they?
No, they didn't have a banner in front of them.
Pastor is there by himself, and there's the roller derby
girls behind me. Yeah, they did do some limbo stuff with me. They said, "Hey, can we do some roller limbo?" So I held it up like this high, and then they're going under it. You know, they.
They
had fun with that. They did. All right, so things vary there. Okay, dear ones. You know, here's number 8. What is some fruit that you've brought forth lately? How can you continue to yield fruit for God? For some of the fruit is the fruit of the Spirit. We have more of the fruit of the Spirit, the love and of joy and, you know, peace and temperance and all those kinds of things. Gentleness. Yeah. So that's some of the fruit that I've been working on too. Fruit. Yeah. Brother John's been discipling someone that's come to Christ, you know, because of his speaking with that person. So, you know. Okay, thank you, dear ones, for being attentive once again for another set of lessons. And Lord willing, as I said, we'll be looking at a whole nother set next Sunday and go on to something different. Any questions on abiding in His provision? Has Christ provided for you? He really has provided great things. And here in America, He's provided not only the love and friendship and the purpose, but He's provided us with so much. You know, just so much.
Amen.
It's amazing. Let's pray together. Father, thank you again for Sunday School Hour. I pray that you would just continue to work, that we'd understand that it's good to abide in Thee. And there's a real joy, and there's real purpose, there's real satisfaction in just abiding in You. And so, Lord, we just look forward to how to learn how to do that and to do it by faith. And we just thank You for it. May the morning service be to Your glory. Thank You for all Your blessings. We love You and need You. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen,
dear ones. Amen.